applicant notice. No. See, yeah, I've told she remembers. What? No. Please write down. Next property. Achha, by the way, wait. We will first discuss Reynolds number. Write down Reynolds number. See, we have discussed little bit about the turbulent flow. Okay, and then we have discussed the property of the fluid flow only when it is laminar. Okay, it is okay to not to discuss property of fluid when the flow is turbulent, but I should know whether flow is laminar or turbulent. Otherwise, I might be applying Bernoulli's theorem where the flow is turbulent. So what is the point? So I am not studying the property of the turbulent flow, but I am just trying to find out, is there a way to check whether it is laminar or turbulent? Because at times you may feel that it is laminar, but it could be turbulent. Okay? So Reynolds number gives us a method to find out whether it is a laminar flow or a turbulent flow. Okay? Now, it is basically an empirical formula. Okay, but then we will try to put some logic in it and see what is the logic behind whatever expression we are getting here. Alright, but I may not be exactly able to derive how it comes, but I will tell you how it is in principle. So, now tell me, if a fluid is viscous, with viscosity of one fluid is more than the viscosity of the other fluid, then where there is a chance the flow will be laminar? More viscous or less viscous?
Less.
Imagine you have honey and let's say water. Okay, honey moving with the same velocity and water moving with the same velocity. Now you increase the velocity and keeping the velocity same, which will become turbulent first?
Honey
will become turbulent. Honey is more viscous. Okay, so honey has a tendency to make sure that all the layers are together. That all the layers are binded by more force, I mean the viscous force. So honey, the chances are more that will remain laminar. Okay, so viscosity is more, the chance is more that it will be a laminar flow. Okay, so now this is one comparison. Please write down, if viscosity is more, chances of laminar flow is more. Okay. Now tell me, if two fluids having the same viscosity, one is moving with higher velocity, other is moving with lower velocity, where the chances of turbulence is more?
Higher
velocity. Right? So this is a straightforward thing. If velocity increases, chances of laminar flow go down. Okay? Fine? So, in principle, there are two factors that you need to check, viscosity as well as velocity. Now, when you compare, you can keep one of the factor constant. Let's say velocity you can keep constant and just check the variation with respect to viscosity. Or you can take viscosity common between the two fluids and check the variation with the velocity. But usually that doesn't happen. I need to find out for a particular fluid only what is the condition for it to be laminar turbulent. I am not comparing them. Okay, so I need to check both viscosity as well as velocity. So it will become a problem to check both ways. Okay, so we are trying to define a third parameter called Reynolds number, which will be a function of both of them. Are you getting? See, what I am trying to say is that it is like this. Mathematically, try to understand. If I say x increases, chances of a turbulence decreases, and if y increases, chances of its turbulence increases. So I will define a parameter x by y, and then I just look at x by y. You understand what I am trying to say? And if x increases, chances of let's check about laminar only. Chances of laminar increases. If y increases, chances of laminar decreases. Are you getting it? So I define x by y as some parameter. Now if x by y increases, it automatically tells us that y is decreasing and x is increasing. So satisfied both the cases? Not getting it. Achha, when it will be laminar? When y decreases, chances of laminar increases. So if x increases and y decreases, x by y will increase. Getting it? Now, if x decreases, y increases, x by y will decrease. Right? So rather than checking x and y separately, I am checking x by y. So it takes into account both. Are you getting what I am trying to say here? Alright. So same thing here also. Reynolds number is a combination of velocity and viscosity, which will give you just one parameter to check, and if that parameter is within some range, it is laminar. Out of that range, turbulent. Okay? Any doubt? No. Now, see, one more thing is very important here, is that I want to define a number which is dimensionless. Okay, if it has dimension, then the geometry will also start mattering, whether the pipe is thinner, bigger, or whatever it is. So I need to define a quantity which is dimensionless. Okay, and I should take into account both viscosity as well as velocity. All right, so I will take a ratio between viscous force, okay, I'll take the ratio between viscous force and the inertial force, and this is my Reynolds number. Please write down. So sorry, Reynolds number is ulta of that, it is reverse of this. Inertial force divided by viscous force. So now tell me, if Reynolds number is less, what does it mean? Viscous force is more, or viscosity is more, and velocity is less?
Laminar.
So laminar flow. And if Reynolds number is more, it means viscous force is less, turbulent flow chances are there. Okay? Now tell me, how do I write the viscous force? I will talk about inertial force later on. Huh? What is viscous force? How do you write it? That is your sphere. I have a definition of coefficient of viscosity, right? F by A divided by?
V by L.
Okay? So F is what? Eta V by L divided by A. Sorry, multiplied by A. V A divided by L. Is this correct? Is this correct? Any doubt? This represents viscous force. Okay. Acha, have we derived the force because of the flow of the water from an orifice? This scenario have we done? Where water is flowing here and it will experience a force this way? No. We have done it, no? Okay, chal nahi kiya, let's do it. So from here, you get the definition of inertial force. Now what is inertial force? Look front. Inertial force is rate of change of momentum only, nothing new about it. Okay? So let us see what it is. If you take a beaker like this, stop talking, Siddharth. Stop talking, Siddharth. I'll ask you to go out now. Why are you asking doubt to him? Me? What is the doubt? What is the doubt? Huh? It doesn't matter actually. I am saying at that instant. Okay? At this instant, let's say velocity is V. Okay? The rate of flow is A into V. dm by dt is what? Rate at which mass is coming out will be rho into A into V. This you know, right? Okay? And rate of change of momentum is what? If velocity is constant, momentum is m into v. So, rate of change of momentum is v into dm by dt. So, this will be rho a into v square. This we haven't done. Okay, so now we are done. So, this is a rate of change of momentum of the fluid that is coming out. And the momentum of the fluid inside the bucket and that which is coming out was zero initially, let us say. So this bucket will experience a force, this side, which is equal to rho A into V square because of the flow of water. It will become like a rocket. Fine? Then this will be equal to mass and acceleration. Mass depends on what is the height. So you get a nice differential equation. There will be numericals which will cater to this scenario. If you solve a good number of questions, you will encounter such questions as well. Fine, so inertial force is basically rho a v square. That happens because water has some mass in it. It has some density. Alright, so this is inertial force. Rho a into v square. So, what will become inertia divided by viscous? Can you divide and tell me what you will get? So Reynolds number is rho v l by eta. This is dimensionless, it has no dimensions. Fine? Okay? Now what is l? L is the thickness of the fluid, it has to do with some dimension. Okay? So I am assuming l to be the diameter of the pipe in which the water is flowing. Now you say no, it is not diameter, something else. What I am saying is, suppose it is diameter, the number will change. That is all will happen, right? So I will define the number according to the diameter itself, not according to the thickness of the fluid. Okay? So Reynolds number will be rho v into diameter of the pipe divided by eta. This is a very, very important parameter. Checking the Reynolds number will help you to find out whether it is laminar or turbulent. Okay? So for a circular cross-section pipe, you will take diameter. What if it is hexagonal or triangular or square, rectangular, then what will you do? What is D in that case? So then you must know, it is not in your NCERT, there is a thing called hydraulic diameter. Hydraulic diameter is 4 times area of cross section divided by perimeter. You can check, this is 2 into R for the circular. For circle, 4 times A is 4 pi r square divided by 2 pi r, which comes out to be 2 r. Okay, if it is not circular, just find out the area of cross section. 4 A divided by perimeter is your capital T. Okay. Now here is a very simple thing, that if Reynolds number is less than 1000, it is laminar. Stop talking. If Reynolds number is greater than 2000, it is turbulent. And between 1000 and 2000, it is called transient state. It is neither laminar nor turbulent. Between 1000 and 2000. Okay. So there will be at times numerical only on to check whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. Okay, and the way the numerical will be asked will be little twisted calculation wise. For example, this one which I am going to give you. But all of you clear about this? Any doubt? And it is not a very sharp zone. Okay, it is a very hazy zone. It transient to it very, very smoothly. So there is nothing a very sharp point defined where after 1000 some force will come out or turbulent now. It will happen very slowly. From 1000 to 1001, you will not even notice what is the difference. Okay? Any other doubt? Huh? Why to pucha usne? I made fun of him. He did not see that. Any other doubt? No doubt. Take it. We'll take a numerical now. Please write down the flow rate of water. The flow rate of the water is 0.48 liters per minute. देखो बात करना बंद कर दो. Flow rate of the water is 0.48 liter per minute in a diameter of 1.25 centimeter. The coefficient of viscosity is 10 raised to the power minus 3 Pascal second. Okay? Find out the Reynolds number. Or you could tell me whether the flow is laminar or turbulent. First, calculate the Reynolds number and tell me how much it is. Thank you. see, we have found out Reynolds number in terms of velocity and everything else. Find out the Reynolds number in terms of flow rate, Q. Okay, and then substitute the values. Q is equal to A into V. Q is volume flow rate, but that is in liters per minute. 1 liter of water, how many kg is?
10,000.
1,000, na? So 1 liter of water, 1,000 kg water will come. 1 liter is 1 kg. Okay. 1 meter cube is 1,000. You are confusing between meter cube and liter.
In
right? The answer is less than 1000. क्या है ये जैसे 100 की लेकर तो आंसर
turbulent flow.
Actually, actual answer is 5095. Reynolds number.
Multiply
5095. So it is a turbulent flow. See, this is another benefit of first finding the expression. Otherwise, you have to do the calculation again for this flow rate. Okay, so every physics problem, get the final expression, what is asked in terms of what is given, and then at the end you substitute the values. Okay, write down next property. Surface tension. Have you seen insect walking on the water surface?
Mosquitoes.
Where have you seen?
Home.
Thank you, man. Okay, so.
You see bath holes. Water bath.
Insect attack, turn this way. Okay, listen here. So, but then there are examples you see around in which some lighter object can be on the surface of the water without going inside the water. For example, when you see the insect walking on the surface of the water, is it because of the buoyant force? No, the insect is not going inside the water. It remains on the surface of the water, but surface of water will act like a membrane, a very very thin membrane. It will act like as if the another good example is as if it is like a balloon filled with air. So on the surface of the balloon, if something is kept, the balloon surface will dip little bit, but it will hold the surface, but it will hold the object. Okay, so the water surface also behaves like a stretched membrane. Fine, and why it does that? Okay, the reason why it does, because of the surface tension. Okay, now first let us see what is so special about the water surface that only the surface is showing this property. As soon as you go inside the water surface, surface tension disappears. Surface tension is only the surface phenomena. It only depends on between which two medium the interface is. Please write down surface tension. Surface tension is a surface phenomena. And the surface represents the interface between the two mediums. Surface represents interface between the two mediums. Okay? So surface tension also only depends on between which two medium the interface is. Between which two mediums the interface is. For example, on a bucket, water is there. So there is an interface or surface between what? Between which two things? Water and air. Okay, so I'm talking about the topmost layer. There is something special about the topmost layer. Alright? Understood? Now let's see what is so special about it. Okay? First, let us see at the atomic level what is happening, or at the molecular level what is happening. Suppose you have a bucket of water. By the way, till now we have ignored the surface tension. We never take into account the surface tension. Slowly and slowly we are talking about realistic fluid. The realistic fluid will show viscosity. Realistic fluid will show the surface tension also. Okay? So this is the surface. Let's see what is so special about the molecules on the surface. Let's say these are two molecules and here are two molecules. The surface will have whole range of molecules, right? This molecule is having interaction among these many molecules. Interaction as in they are getting attracted to the neighboring molecules. If they don't get attracted by the neighboring molecules, suppose they are getting repelled, then it will no longer be a liquid. It will be gas. The molecules, there is some van der Waals force or the hydrogen bonding force, something which is holding the molecule close to each other. They don't let one molecule escape. Otherwise, it will no longer be liquid. So, net-net, there is a force of attraction among the molecules. Alright? Now, this molecule is getting attracted by so many molecules, whereas this molecule is getting attracted by only these many. There is nothing at the top, right? So on the surface, the molecule has lesser attractive force. All of you agree with this? Okay, now tell me, which is more stable?
The inside
one, it is getting attracted by multiple this thing. Okay, so no, this is also an equilibrium, this will not move. The repulsion will be there to make sure it is above. And suppose it comes down, something has to be on the surface, right? All of them can't be inside the water. There will be surface. Okay? So, but what I am saying is, more is the attraction, more is the stability and lesser the energy it has. All of you understood this? Lesser energy it will have. For example, what example should I give you? For example, let's say spring. Okay, spring will have repulsion. As you compress the spring, spring will push you away. Why? Because it has excess energy. It wants to get rid of excess energy. Every object in this universe wants to decrease its energy as much as possible. Are you getting it? So similarly, molecules also. So if this molecule has a lesser energy and this surface molecule have the more energy, this molecule or the collection of all these molecules want to decrease their energy. And how they can decrease energy? Can they get rid of surface? No, that is not an option. Then what else they can do? What is the next possible thing they can do? They can decrease the number of molecules on the surface. And how can they do that? How can they decrease the number of molecules on the surface? Huh? As in, what do you mean? What do you say? You said something, right? Getting away with this. If the distance between the two molecules remains same, that is why it is liquid. Okay? We are not increasing or decreasing. We are not letting it expand or contract. Okay? So, what else they can do? Decrease the surface area. If they decrease the surface area, number of molecules will
decrease.
Please write down the natural tendency of the surface. The natural tendency of the surface is to decrease the surface area. Natural tendency of surface molecules, right? Please write down molecule also. The natural tendency of surface molecules is to decrease the surface area, thereby decreasing the surface energy. Thereby decreasing the surface energy. Are you getting it? Now, all of you written? Thereby decreasing the surface energy. So, Now for a given volume of the fluid, given volume, okay, if volume is fixed, I don't know whether you have done this thing as a numerical or not. If volume is fixed, the least possible surface, least possible shape is the shape which has least possible surface area for a given volume is spherical. Okay, please write down. And hence, they tend to make a spherical shape. So basically, if you throw liquid in space, it will become spherical. The drop, the bubble, all of these are spherical in shape. That is a natural tendency. Okay, but because of gravity, the shape gets distorted. But if gravity is not there, only surface tension will be the phenomena that will be active, and because of that, the spherical shape will be observed. Getting it? Any doubt? Okay. Now we have just discussed the surface tension in the form of, let's say, I mean, we have discussed in words only. Now we need to quantify it. What do you think? How should we quantify it? Surface tension, let's say everybody has agreed we will be defining surface tension. We will be representing surface tension by S. Okay? And if it is between air and liquid, I will write AL as a subscript. So it is surface tension between air and liquid. So how should I define it? Should I say that the amount of surface energy the surface has is the surface tension? Will it be a proper definition? What is the problem with this definition? What is the problem? Can I say that the surface energy represents the surface tension? I can say that. Why not? But the one small problem will be that if I take a bigger mass, surface energy will be more, surface area is more. A smaller mass of the same fluid will have lesser surface energy, right? But surface tension should not depend on how much fluid I am taking. So I should define in such a way that that parameter is same whether I take a smaller fluid object or a bigger fluid object. So rather than defining as surface energy completely, I am saying it is surface energy per unit surface area, which is same for both. Are you getting it? Alright, so surface tension is, write down surface energy, it is density of surface energy divided by surface area. Any doubt? No doubt? Now suppose there is an agent. Suppose there is something which is increasing the area. Which is increasing the area. For example, if I take a film between, I mean, here is a film, okay, this is a film. And if I stretch this film from this side, film will oppose it or not? It will oppose it because the area is increasing, right? So naturally a force is developed. Are you getting it? There is a force that is developed because it doesn't want to increase its area. Otherwise its energy will increase. Fine. So surface tension also creates a force of opposing the increase in the cross-section area or the area of the surface. Alright? So I can define surface tension in terms of force as well. Are you getting what I am trying to say? This is a surface tension in terms of surface energy. Now if you define surface tension in terms of force, it will be, first we will write down, then you will understand as you move forward. Force per unit length. So this is one of those rare physical quantity which is defined from the energy point of view as well as from the force point of view. So you can get the force also from here, and as well as you can get the energy from the surface tension. Force will be surface tension to length, and surface energy will be surface area into surface tension. Are you getting it? Now, one more thing I want to discuss with you is that surface area, there is no ambiguity. You know what is surface and what is surface area, but which length I am talking about here? Which length? It could be any length you draw on the surface. Okay, it is an internal force. Like for example, a stretched balloon. A balloon is there filled with air. There is a stretching force. Which direction it is? In all directions, right? Similarly here also. So if you draw a line on the surface tension force will act perpendicular to that line, like this. Okay. Any imaginary line you draw, okay, surface tension will act perpendicular to line. It will not let that line move perpendicular to itself. Otherwise, the surface area will increase. If this line moves like this, surface area is increasing. So force will oppose that. So the developed force will be perpendicular to the line which you are imagining. Please write it down. The surface tension force will be perpendicular to the So what I was saying was surface tension force will act perpendicular to the length which you are imagining. Okay? Any doubt? Achha, by the way, are you seeing for the first time why the energy is creating force? You know what is the relation between potential energy and the force? What it is? Force is equal to minus of derivative of the potential energy, and force into displacement, the work done by the conservative force is negative of change in energy, potential energy, right? So there is a relation between force and the energy. Alright? So now let us talk about two experiments. Yeah, that is what I am going to calculate. Okay. Now we are going to calculate the surface tension. We are going to discuss two experiments which we will be using to calculate the surface tension by first definition and then by the second definition of the surface tension. Okay? So please draw this experiment one. You have a frame like this. A frame like this. This length is L. This is L. And this is the fill. Do you know what is a fill? Okay. Now, you are moving this link with, let us say, force F. Force F is very, very small, which lets this link move with almost zero velocity. Extremely slowly you are moving. Okay? So there will be an opposite force also because of the film. Yes or no? And perpendicular to this length. Alright? So this force, what it does is it moves by a distance of D. Okay? Now I want you to apply work energy theorem between the initial and the final condition. Let's say surface tension is S. What is the theorem between when piston is here and then when it is here?
Surface tension is surface energy per unit area. So multiply with area.